Hi everyone, this is Chandri Kishore from Indian Environment Network. Let me welcome you all on this precast on the Global Learning School series that we have started. And this is first in the series, and I'm very fortunate to have with me Mr. Sanjay Aggarwal. He's the CEO of Clover Organic Private Limited and a longtime member of our Indian Environment Network. We have learned from him a lot, and while starting this series, he was the first one that came to my mind, which could educate us and let us know how actually we do something. Because there's no dearth of ideas in this market, but someone who actually implements that ideas, those people are rare. So again, we are very fortunate to have Mr. Sanjay Aggarwal. A brief about Mr. Sanjay. Mr. Sanjay, he did his MBA from XLRI, Jamshedpur, and then he wanted to do something to conserve the environment, and he hit upon this idea. But before I talk more about him, let me ask Mr. Sanjay to introduce himself and tell us more about him. So Mr. Sanjay, the platform is yours.
Okay, thanks, Chandler. Well, welcome everybody. I think they are mostly Indians over here, so good evening to everyone. For those who can hear me, I'm doing this for the first time, so pardon any mistakes or whatever that might happen. Okay, a bit about my personal life so far, which has been pretty interesting and diverse. I started dabbling with microbes way back in the late 80s. This was with Dr. Higa's EM technology. And I sold that, those bottles that we used to get from Japan and make them in our factory for about 10 years. And then I realized that just introducing microbes into an environment is not going to really make that magic that we all look for. So thereafter, I thought of creating environments or solutions, complete end-to-end solutions for any given problem that people face. So one of the problems, of course, was lakes. But besides that, Clover is into two verticals. One is farming, where we do agriculture, animal husbandry, and aquaculture. All these segments contain, innovative and ecological solutions that we offer. And in the second vertical is pollution control, where we look at wastewater treatment and solid waste management. So lake definitely is a very, very important asset of our country. And I do not know if some of you attended some of the lectures which were delivered earlier and by my good friend Sunita Narayan, our Center for Science and Environment, and many books have been written. Approximately 10 to 15% or maybe a higher percentage of lakes have already disappeared in this country, and they are disappearing almost daily. So we thought it's time to do something about it. Unfortunately, there was no ready available technology available to actually address this issue. We studied various case studies which were presented by various organizations on what they had done about lake treatment, and I found personally that except for dredging, they were not doing much. So it was cleaning of lake and not restoration of lakes, as it were.
Okay.
So just by cleaning a lake. Sorry.
This Delhi project, is it your first project, or did you do lake cleaning before that too?
No, this was my first project, because that was the only way I could learn. Could learn how to clean a lake.
Okay, that's great. So it's amazing that you could sell this concept to Delhi Development Authority. What gave them the confidence to go with you on this cleaning of the project?
Well, I can't answer for them as to what gave them the confidence, but there were multiple presentations that we gave. We met all the officials, we gave them our credentials, so I guess that must have worked.
Okay, that's great. But yeah, so if you can tell us a little about what other things that you did before that, which gave you the confidence of starting with cleaning the lake.
Our
Like few
main
projects
focus.
that you,
Yes.
yeah, the few projects
We
that you
are
have done
already.
earlier.
We are basically into biologically cleaning up the sewage treatment plants and effluent treatment plants of various companies. And we are fortunate to be working with companies like ITC, Procter & Gamble, Sarmila, etc., etc. So when we found that we could bring down the pollution level by 98, 99% in those ETPs and STPs, so why not lakes? Why not ponds?
Okay.
So that gave us a, you know, a much bigger, how should I say, confidence.
Okay, that's great. And can you tell us a little about your company and the products that you have that you came up with and that you are using in your present technology of cleaning the pollution and everything?
You need to repeat that, Chandra. I didn't get your question.
Sorry. I wanted to know more about your company and the products that, as a company, you are producing that you are using in your projects.
Hello. I think the audio was lost in the middle somewhere, Chandra.
Okay, sorry. I wanted to know a little more about your company, so, and the products that you are using.
We use a consortium of different microbes. We have microbiologists working in our organization, and we also have a tie-up with a company called Biosa in Denmark. And through them, we make these different consortiums for different applications.
Okay. And what are your main products that come out of it? Is it a specific product that you have given a brand name, or it's like you produce it just based on project by project?
No, we have we okay, yeah, definitely. We have different products for different applications within wastewater itself. Like we have the one which was used in the lake cleaning was, I'll just show you the product. And if you can see it, it's called
Yeah, I see.
NatureWell WW. And
Okay.
this dark liquid that you are seeing inside, this contains trillions of beneficial microbes inside them.
Okay.
And these actually are the engines which actually go and do the cleaning.
Okay.
Okay,
So,
and
go. Yeah, go
yeah,
ahead.
sorry. Yeah,
Go
and
ahead.
now just putting the microbes in a lake also is not going to work. And you know, there are many methods that we utilize in doing that. I just want to know, Chandra. I mean, I just want to find out if these people who are there, all the visitors, are they actually listening in? They have any queries so far? Because, you know, any reactions, just to know that they're all there.
A couple of housekeeping, so because I think even for the audience, this is a new method and a new platform. So
Yeah, sure.
let me give you some housekeeping things. You can see this presentation that we have put online. If it is interfering with you, you can just click on it and drag the window to anywhere that is very convenient on your desktop. So it need not be at a position where it's interfering with you. So you can just drag this presentation and keep it wherever you want. Second thing is that if you have a question or anything, you can just go, you can see a question button right here. You can just click on it and put a question there, or on your right, there's a chat screen where you can just ask us a question and we'll be happy to answer you on that. So you're welcome to just start chatting here and asking questions. I know, again, this is a new platform, but this is very easy. And also, if someone has a camera, so they can just click on the camera button and just ask me if they, to come online, and you can even come online and ask a question. So those are the simple things that you could do. But again, you're welcome to ask questions and as we go along, and just ask anytime you want. So anyway, let's go back, Mr. Sanjay. So we were talking about this lake cleaning. What baseline survey was undertaken that before cleaning and restoration of the lake, and what were your findings?
Well, when we went there for the first time, we were absolutely shocked, you know, because it was a myriad of problems. We had, you know, three drains passing through, you know, the, how should I say, the park where this was being, you know, where the lake was. And two of those drains, unfortunately, belonged to Delhi Jal Board, on which DDA had no authority. And many of that sewage was actually seeping into the lake and polluting it like crazy. So it was a tough task for us to put both of these organizations on a common platform and get them to agree to do their respective jobs. So first we actually addressed the external issues where the pollution was actually coming in into the lake. Without addressing that, we could not you know, hope to clean the lake at all. And thereafter we started our operations, and we were given just 40-45 days to show some kind of a result, which is again a very, very uphill task for a, you know, water body like a lake.
Yeah, so like how important it is to address external sources of pollution before focusing on the lake itself?
Well, I mean, it's like you are going to a doctor and you're telling him to cure you without you stopping drinking poison. So, you know, unless you actually do that, you cannot actually get cured. So you got to stop, you know, drinking that. So we had to stop all that sewage going in, which was leading to something called eutrophication in the lake, where there was a huge amount of algal growth, and it was cutting off the sunlight, thereby killing the, you know, microflora, which was there in the bottom of the lake, which was affecting the fish population, because some of you might know that dissolved oxygen levels in water keeps on going down as and as, you know, the more and more pollution or the organic load increase, you know, gets introduced into the water.
Okay. Yeah, Karthik has a very interesting question. He's asking, was the lake you were using annually were bogged down with idols of Ganesh during Ganesh Chaturthi or not?
Yeah, Karthik, it was not only Ganesh Chaturthi, but I think Delhi being a Delhi and a cosmopolitan place like that, we had the Jhat Puja happening, but the Biharis coming and throngs and having a great dip in that lake. We had the poor people from the neighboring areas coming and washing their clothes in that. We have, you know, the children and normal people who was to come and throw the garbage into it. So, it, you know, it was an amazing amount of challenges where I think we had to first educate the people to actually become stakeholders in many ways to, you know, actually clean the lake or restore the
lake.
Yeah,
I think yeah, it's like a kind of social fencing that you're talking about, right? So how were you successful in putting that social fencing by educating those people?
Well, we had, you know, high number of actually, you know, senior citizens visiting those, within the park where the lake was. And it was... how should I say, literally a place of worship for them, because that's the place they used to meet their friends and family. And it was amazing they could be away from family, have their own space. So they actually were the driving force behind this entire exercise. And they helped us to educate other people not to litter the thing. And we also posted our posters at our cost and everything there.
Okay. So besides the social fencing, so what was the different technologies that you deployed while cleaning the lake through this organic means?
Well, there were actually multiple technologies used. We used our microbes that I just showed you, the NatureWell WW. These are a consortium of microbes. So we actually carried out bioremediation through microbes, and we carried out phytoremediation by planting Kenna plants around the lake.
Okay.
Now, Kenna is a wonderful plant, which is, you know, very, very common to most Indian cities. I'm not talking about the exotic version, I'm talking about the native species. And this plant actually sucks out the pollution from the lake. And third was, of course, we use surface aeration by putting in aspirators, which I got from the US.
Okay.
So three technologies were used in tandem to actually clean up the lake.
And did this also involve dredging of the lake?
Yes, in the initial, before we actually started restoring the lake, we had to clean the lake because it was, well, you can call it a sewage pond in many ways in some parts, and it was a garbage dump also in many parts. So we had to actually get labor, which was not easy because 90% people don't want to touch garbage in India. It's a, big problem, you know. So we had to get the right rag pickers, pay them double the amount of money, somehow come there and do the job.
Oh, wow.
So cleaning had to be done, yes.
So, like, how long was the project, and like initial, how many days did you take in first cleaning the pond before it was actually ready to put in your technology?
Well, we had scheduled that we would take about a week to clean the lake, but it took about 12 to 13 days to actually do the job. And thereafter, we started using these different technologies in tandem.
Okay. So, what was the function of this using your mud balls that you are saying for cleaning water?
Yes, the miracle balls. Yes, I'm going to show you that.
Yes, right.
Okay, see, can you see this? This is a mud ball which was made from the lake sediment. And it has zeolite powder, it has molasses, it has rice bran and things like that. And after this ball is made, it grows a fungus. I'm just trying to show you one. Can you see this white fungus on this?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So this actually grows to about a couple of inches, and it smells lovely. Actually, it's a very nice smell. And what this ball does is that it becomes as hard as a cricket ball, and thereafter we throw them into the lake, say about one ball per square meter roughly.
Okay.
And thereafter, these balls, because of their weight, they sink right to the bottom of the lake and slowly start to melt with the water.
Oh, okay.
And when they melt with the water, there's a slow release mechanism of the microbes. So they start cleaning the bottom of the lake, which is the most important part, and what we also call the hypo layer, you know, the hypolimnion layer. So that layer gets cleaned up with this lake because that's the nutrient-rich layer of any lake in the world.
Okay. So to get some perspective, how big was this lake, and for cleaning this, how many of these balls you had to put in?
Well, the lake was approximately 2.5 acres. So say about 2.5 acres, and we had to make and use about 10,000 balls, roughly.
Oh, wow.
To put inside. Then we had to use a boat, and all the boats were in a pathetic state. They all had holes in them. So we had to get them repaired ourselves, and somehow went to the lake.
Right.
And so we had a team of people who were managing it, and thereafter we had to also have our own security, because DDA had just one or two guards who were mostly not seen around the place. And we certainly did not want the people to enter the lake again once it's been clean. So that's how it went.
Right. Oh, okay. So, Karthik is asking this question, is like, what was the support of the local self-government and how did this project came about? Well, it was, I believe that this was DDA who sponsored this project, right?
Yeah, the DDA sponsored the project. I hope there are no government people watching this show. It was very, very tough to get any kind of support from these guys. Very, very tough indeed, you know. And most of the time, they have to involve us in all kinds of non-lake cleaning processes as well. So one had to remove stones from the different locations just to make it look beautiful or whatever, which was not really in our purview, but then we had to do it.
Okay.
So it was, I mean, it was crazy. And, you know, and we tried to get the government to say, okay, look, we have done it, and can you kind of give us some certificate at least? And they refused to even do that. Mm-hmm. So it was tough. It was tough.
Based on our experience, so like there are so many environment professionals right here. What would you suggest them if they see like a polluted lake in their city or township or municipality? What is your recommendation to going about it and approaching them and getting this kind of project going?
Well, so it's difficult to really answer that because, you know, I tell you, I'm not going to name anybody, but in my experience, I've seen so many organizations coming, you know, in the name of trying to conserve the environment. And unfortunately, they don't do that. It's a trade-off mostly, you know, with the government. And so it depends on a person's objective. You know, when he sees a polluted lake or, you know, a pollution, let's say a solid waste somewhere lying around, or, you know, somebody, let's say, polluting, you know, different parts of the environment or lake, one has to take his own call, really, you know, I mean, what he wants to do. And if he wants to do it, technologies are available. That's not an issue at all.
Okay. But like, do you think that if people around the area, if they can sensitize those people, they can become a really powerful force behind them
Absolutely. You got to be absolutely passionate. You got to be, you know, absolutely, how should I say, in love with what you do and prepared to go the distance against all odds. So, I would strongly, you know, suggest that, you know, people should follow their passions. And, you know, everybody comes, everybody tries to do something, but make a difference, you know, make a 1%, 0.5% difference is what I would like to advocate.
Okay, that's great. Coming back to the technology that you used, you showed us that Nature Bell, but like, what exactly it is? Is it a certified organic? What is its function? Can you tell a little more about that Nature Bell?
Chandra, sorry, the audio got lost again.
Oh, sorry. I was saying that. Again, you showed us Nature Well. Is it a certified organic? What is its function? Can you tell us a little more about it?
Yeah, okay. Nature Well is a consortium of, well, earlier it was just 3 microbes and we have made it into 10 different microbes. The main genuses are lactobacillus, yeast, and photosynthetic bacteria. And it is certified by EcoCert of France. They have an office in Aurangabad, and it is completely a safe product to actually utilize for these kind of things. Just to exhibit, since we're on video, I hope people are not watching this part.
Oh wow, don't do that. Wow.
Yeah. So, actually, if you drink 2 caps of this on a daily basis, nobody will have a stomach problem ever.
Oh wow, it is the first time that we see a cleaning product that can be drunk as well. So
you know, it is amazing product because it's a very, very strong probiotic and a very strong antioxidant. So it's an amazing product that way, because a lot of people are, in fact, in Europe, It's a drink. It's a health drink more than a product to clean up lakes and agriculture, you know, purposes.
Oh wow! So how did you hit upon the idea of using this as a lake cleaning product?
Sorry, just repeat that.
How did you hit upon the idea of cleaning using this as a lake cleaning product?
Well, like I told you, that initially I started my career in the late 80s, and I was fortunate to have met Dr. Higa. And thereafter, I learned about some of the things that they had done with their own product to clean up water bodies. But again, okay. There was no scientific or any evidence available as to what one could do. So yes, I knew that we could do the cleaning with this product. To what extent, again, we had to really see for ourselves in Indian conditions against all the various challenges one faces. So we actually use this in many forms. Like I told you, I showed you the, one was the, the clay ball, which I've already shown you guys. And second was we sprayed this on the banks of the lake, and by doing that, what happens is that the microbes start residing in the banks of the lake, the sludge gets reduced, and as the water touches the banks, it starts to get cleaned up. So they become like water scrubbers.
Okay.
So actually it was a huge learning exercise for us, to get this opportunity from DDA to clean up this one lake.
Yeah, that's amazing. But can you think, do you know that this process of cleaning, can we upscale it? Can we use it into another bigger lake now? Are you confident about it?
I'm 100% confident that we could use this product, but like I'm saying, the product usage is possibly 10% of the entire, effort one puts in into cleaning lakes, because there would be 100 different, data that you need to actually collect before you attempt to even touch a lake. That's one learning that we got.
So, what kind of data are you talking about?
Yeah, I'm talking about, for example, the dimensions, the catchment area, the kind of fauna which resides over there. We actually, didn't even look at it too much, and that's very, very important. And the fish species which are there, then what is the water quality before you touch the lake, after you do the lake. Then we even look at the complete satellite imagery of the lake to assess that where can we do what and what is the water depth in different parts of the lake. So, hundreds of actually data is collected before this lake cleaning happens. And I can also tell you that it's not a quick fix solution. It can take years sometimes to actually see a tangible result, because you are not attempting to just clean, you're trying to restore an ecosystem.
Right.
So that's one has to really understand.
So what you are recommending is that we should do like a proper environment impact assessment of that lake ecosystem before approaching it, and then you can come up with the right solution, right?
Well, something like that, Chandra. But then, if you look at a typical EIA, you're looking at, okay, if you do something, then what will happen to the environment? That's a typical model of EIAs are designed. But here you already have the lake. So I've found that most EIA's formats actually fail to capture, the essential data sets that we need before we look at lake cleaning.
But like, who are the people who should be involved initially doing the impact assessment and giving you the inputs, and what kind of inputs you need before you can even start a lake restoration project?
See, the inputs, I've already told you that different data sets are there. We have a set format. We are more than happy to share it with people who are
wanting
to.
That would be great.
We can actually do that. And secondly, the best part about this is that anyone can actually clean up a lake.
Okay,
it's not that you need an environmental engineer to do that. You don't need
that. That's very enlightening, yes. Yeah, that's very enlightening that anyone can clean the project. So what do you think are the steps that any person who wants to clean a project needs to take?
Sorry, just repeat that.
If anyone wants to clean the lake, what are the steps he needs to take in order to go through the process?
Number one is a complete survey. Like I said, survey is very, very important. And thereafter, once you've got all the data, then you actually need to make a plan. And mm-hmm. that plan would be divided into two parts, essentially. One is controlling the external, sources of pollution, number one. Mm-hmm. And then looking into the internal sources of pollution as to where it's coming in. So we actually have two sets of plans to do that. So once that the first phase is completed, then we look at the second phase.
Okay. And
yeah. So and that is one thing. And sorry for
interrupting. Go ahead, please.
Yeah. So that is one thing. So what I'm trying to say by all this is that if you have the passion to actually address water bodies, you can do it. You don't need an environmental engineering degree or environmental sciences degree. Sure, it will help you, but it's not a prerequisite to actually clean up these water bodies. It's a very interesting and very exciting prospect actually to do that. And one can do it actually.
Mm-hmm. So again, what are the hurdles that you faced while cleaning and restoring the lake? So if people know about it and take care of it while working on such lake cleaning.
I lost the beginning part of what you said, Chandra.
Again, what are the hurdles that you faced while cleaning the project? Hurdles. What are the problems that you faced?
Hurdles. One is, I think the biggest, once we got the clearance from the government, that we could do it, the biggest hurdle, unfortunately for us, were the people itself, who are not really looking at the lake to be a clean lake, barring a small minority. And only after we did the, and it was not that they were doing it deliberately or anything. Mm-hmm. What I found was that they just required a bit of awareness from people to, or from us, to actually understand the importance of a clean and absolutely a pure lake where everybody could utilize it and kind of share it. So that was one mm-hmm. hurdle that we faced. Second hurdle was, I guess, keeping it clean thereafter, because we moved out after 45 days, the contract period or whatever. And whether the people would actually take, support of each other to make sure that the lake remains the way it is. So that was another big challenge.
Mm-hmm.
And so these are the main two things, besides that, I don't think we had any other major problem.
Mm-hmm. So again, Karthik has an interesting question. What is your agenda for 2014? Are you cleaning at least four or five more lakes? Have you approached anyone to do that? Or what can be done in the future and how are you involved in it?
Sorry, just repeat that. I was losing that. Are you talking about the agenda for 2014?
Yes, exactly. It says that, are you cleaning more lakes in 2014 or not?
We are attempting to do that. There are a lot of inquiries which have poured in since we did this lake. Mm-hmm. And now we are hoping to clean, like I wrote written in the chat session also, that at least five lakes in the next year. Definitely want five lakes to be cleaned up. Mm-hmm. I'm saying that we've got inquiries from about 15, 20 different states where they want our support to actually clean the lake.
Oh, that's amazing that people have started really interested in cleaning the project through you. I see this presentation that you have. Can you give us a brief? I know that our audience can go through it during the leisure, but if you can give us the main highlights of this presentation, then it will be very beneficial to the audience.
Okay, I think I'll just skip most of the slides where, we've talked about the company. I mean, anybody wants to know more about Clova, I'll just put in the website and people can kind of go through it. But right now it is being upscaled, our website. In the meantime, if you want information on lakes, I'm just putting this in as well. The email that anybody wants can kind of log in. Okay.
Go ahead.
Okay. One thing also I want to bring in Chandra into this one major, how should I say, science that we brought into the lake cleaning. I don't know how many of the audience or people know about biomimicry. We utilize that a lot. I mean, when you talk about aeration, phytoremediation, and all those different technologies, they have a single platform, and that is biomimicry. I mean, I'm absolutely fascinated by this science, and I would request people to, kind of log in into my favorite website called TED.com, which I log on to very, very often. And there, actually, type in biomimicry, and there, my best friend. I mean, not. I mean, I. She's. I guess she doesn't even know I exist. But Jan Inbinius, the founder of Biomimicry Institute, which Clover is a member. And I mean, I don't know about others, but it transformed my life. And this slide, if you look at slide number 15, yes, Karthik, I acknowledge that most solutions are there out nature. Yeah. So this slide talks about just this, and it talks the science basically for people who don't know much about biomimicry is that nature is a system where we think everything is absolutely perfect. It's a symbolic idea of the most perfect ecosystem one can even think of. And it took nature 3.8 billion years of research and development, or R&D, what we call evolution. And it was not the way we now see it. It was in a pretty haphazard way when the planet was created. So through these 3.8 billion years, it actually went through a process of becoming perfect and learning for itself. So it has thrown up something like 50 to 60 million solutions for people who want to actually use those solutions to solve today's problems. Some of them I'm just sharing with you. Can everybody see the slides, I hope? I mean, the presentation.
Anyone who wants to, they can just click on the next slide button and
Okay,
go to the
slide
slide
number.
number
Okay.
15.
Yeah, please. Please look at slide number 16. The Volvo car company, it studied that the locusts are basically, they come in swarms, trillions and billions of them. They fly about less than a centimeter apart, but there's not a collision between one locust with other. And we have
Oh,
something
wow.
like, I'm told, 25 lakh car accidents happening, collisions happening in this country on a yearly basis. So they've studied that and they found that there was a large sensor, each of these locusts. And they have put that design, they studied that, replicated it, and they are putting it into their cars now. So, the drivers get to know that they're next to each other. It's a stunning kind of, it's just a learning from nature. Then, if you look at the lotus, it grows in the murkiest of areas, but the lotus leaf is always clean. And one found there were ridges made on the lotus, which actually forced the water to take away the dirt particles. So, a company called Sto, STO, has made a paint called Lotusen, where when you use that paint on the outside walls, it makes those same ridges and the rainwater washes away the dirt. Guaranteed for 25 years. What more do you want? Okay, and
So it's
slide. Yeah, sorry, Chandra. Yeah, tell me.
No, go ahead. I was saying that it's absolutely amazing. I think we have just started scratching the surface of biomimicry, and people are really doing a lot of amazing work in it. So go ahead.
And then we have the bullet train. It used to pass through a tunnel and used to make strange kind of sound, and there was a lot of problems in running the train at the speeds that it runs at. So the engineers looked at the kingfisher bird, where it actually dips down into the water, picks up the fish and flies out without even creating a ripple. Mm-hmm. So if you look at the bullet train, it was designed around the aerodynamic design of a kingfisher bird.
Wow.
That resulted in 25% higher velocity and 15% saving in fuels.
Right. Yeah. Kartik saying that builders are mimicking termite hills for addressing cooling. So that's also a good piece of information.
Yeah, I don't know if, I'm sure Kartik is aware that be it extreme cold or warm weather, the inside of termite hills has a certain temperature, if I'm not wrong, 23.4 degrees Celsius. And it stays that way 24/7. And so builders are looking at it to save energy, you know, to build buildings like that and save energy. So, you know, a lot of these things are kind of happening, you know, all over the place. Okay, then quickly, then we go to slide 19, if anybody mm-hmm. can go to that. I've just mentioned a bit about 7 points on how phytoremediation helps in mm-hmm. cleaning up, you know, the pollution. Mm-hmm. And okay, this slideshow doesn't allow you to go through each and every microbe in slide number 20, but I could email this presentation to anybody who wants it. And
we'll get it embedded right in our website, so everyone can download it. No problem about that.
Yeah, so that you know, people can have a look at individual microbes which are there in wastewater and how responsible they are. Now, another thing I want to mention about this nature well here is the microbes in this actually do not do the cleaning. What they do is that they create a balance of, you know, bringing in more beneficial microbes than harmful microbes in a ecosystem like water.
Okay.
So the microbes which are mentioned in this page number, so the slide number 20, some of them only are mentioned, of course. Mm-hmm. They come together and they do the cleaning.
By using this product,
you actually bring in about a billion times more beneficial microbes to actually do your job.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So that's another thing. Okay, I'll mm-hmm. quickly just skip those to the slide here. I've talked most about it. We've covered lake banks and fermented mud balls. Okay, slide number 28, if people can switch to.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
This was what the lake looked like when we went there.
Oh, okay.
Yeah?
So what was the quality of water before you started the work on cleaning this project?
Well, I'll show you the figures later on, the subsequent slides, but it was in some cases pure sewage, and mm-hmm. in some cases it was very, very dirty water, extremely, extremely dirty water. So mm-hmm. That was one thing. Sorry, Chandra, can I just answer Karthik's questions? He's asked two questions.
Certainly. Go ahead.
Okay, Karthik, fishes were, I don't know whether they were introduced into the lake or not. I really have no idea about that. But can you ask, okay, you have my email and maybe you can ask me more specific question about the mud ball, because what specific more ideas or information you want. And I can probably answer you.
Something more about mud ball. One thing I wanted to ask.
Yeah, tell me.
What were the main contaminants in this lake water that was very evident?
Well, it was actually a toss up between the raw sewage coming into the lake, and also it was the solid mm-hmm. waste that people were throwing in. I mean, if you see the bottom of the slide, the picture, you can see some of the solid waste just being thrown there. And people were indiscriminately mm-hmm. just throwing, you know, I mean, somebody has something to eat and they throw the wrapper inside the lake. It was pretty bad, you know, and toffees and banana peels and what have you. It was everything in the lake.
Okay. Yeah, from this picture, it's like totally looking so really, really contaminated.
Yeah, so this was the lake before we treated it. And then slide number 29, if you can see, this is a picture of one of our, you know, workers there who was planting the Kenna plant on the banks of the lake. And even to get this simple plant, I mean, you talk about challenges. In Delhi, we had to run political post to actually get these simple native species of Kenna, you know, because people, you have those hybrid and amazing colored varieties, which you don't do the work. So this was a problem. And coming back to what Kartik is asking, raw sewage from unorganized drainage sources. No, it was not unorganized drainage sources, Kartik. It was organized in the sense that there were three drains going through the lake. I could send you special pictures of that later on. Two out of the three drains belong to Delhi Jal Board. And unfortunately, the passageway, it was leaking and leaching into the lake. So they agreed and they sent their people. They actually they repaired that entire passage. So the sewage stopped actually leaching into the lake. That was after that we accepted the order. Otherwise, you would not have probably taken the order from DDA to clean the lake.
Yeah, that's very interesting. But like the planting of this Kenna plant, like how much
Yeah.
time does it take, and when does it start really becoming effective?
Kenna starts getting effective, pretty much couple of days just after you plant it. And for some strange reason, it actually loves pollution. It grows, it thrives. You grow Kenna on sewage, it'll grow like crazy. You know, you have, in fact, if some of you engineers, you might have heard of the reed bed system of cleaning sewage, which was advocated early as a technology. And in that, the main constituent was, the Kenna plant. So it pretty much takes off. It becomes, you know, a number of bushes of this come up.
That's amazing. So after dredging, this was the second step that you did, right?
This was, see, after the dredging and the cleaning up of the water, like I said, we used all these technologies together. The last part, of course, was this of putting the Kenna plant there. And we were continuously spraying the banks with Nature Well. We were spraying the lake with Nature Well. We had a separate team of people who were making these 10,000 mud balls and using them and putting them in the lake. And, you know, sometimes once we took the boat initially, and the boat sank, so we actually had to come back and, you know,
Oh my God,
repair that.
I
Well, except we're losing those some mud balls, everything else was fine. So yeah, it was exciting. It was fun in
nothing
many ways. Yeah.
happened.
So
So from start to finish, like how much did you take? How many days?
See, start to finish, like I said, we have a bound by this DDA order. We begged that we be extended the period, but they refused for whatever reason. So we only had about 45 odd days to show some kind of a decent, how should I say, tangible result. And fortunately, the lake wasn't so big, it was just 2 to 2.5 acres. So, and we assessed the whole situation, how much we could do, and so we went ahead and we did it.
Yeah, it's always very difficult when you have like a certain time constraint on something that is happening for years and years.
Yeah, absolutely.
So it's
Absolutely.
difficult.
Absolutely.
It's difficult, but go ahead and let's see what else you have on the slides, and then we can go to the next thing.
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm just finishing this presentation, Chandra. So for people who have seen slide 28, if you could see slide 30. and compare the difference.
Mm-hmm. Wow. And, yes.
You know, this was the difference that we created, and I'm not saying it's the best result or something. If given more time, possibly we could have done a better job. No doubt about it.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So, I guess, this was the slide number 31. You asked the question earlier about the water quality. And,
okay, so you have this details about the water quality right here. So, everyone can do that.
Another thing about measuring this, I would advise everybody to do measurement from at least 4 or 5 different locations. You know,
mm-hmm.
And make sure that the result is taken and still waters, because otherwise you get very, very absurd results. For example, we were taking some water quality, and just before taking it, about 5 boys jumped into the lake.
Oh,
and,
wow.
And that was it. I mean, we had to wait for a couple of hours before the water became calm again. So, if you take readings from only one location, it would possibly give you a lot of errors. So these are the figures which I wanted to show you guys. pH was alkaline, which is typical of sewage before the treatment, and it became stabilized after we, to some extent, it should be ideally 7.5 after treatment. The total dissolved solids were very, very high because of presence of solid waste initially. Total suspended solids, we managed to reduce by a very, very small percentage in that limited time frame we got. Turbidity increased a bit after the treatment, basically because, the aspirators were working, there was churning, and, because of that, some of the sediments went up, and that's the reason why suspended particles were not, had not settled. Okay, alkalinity, of course, reduced, and so did the phosphorus content, because we used zeolite in these mud balls as well, and to some extent, when it went down to the hypo layer, which we talked about earlier, and that limited the amount of phosphorus generation from the sediment in the bottom of the lake. Okay, so DO and everything, yes, it was great. I told the lab which was checking. I mean, the DO levels, I don't agree with them myself. 17.3 is unheard of, and so is 56. I would ignore it completely. It was, I'm sorry, but this was what we got. We had to present, So this was it. The biological oxygen demand is one interesting. I was very, very excited about this. That from 150. Plus, it became less than 50, which was excellent.
Right,
I mean, the biological load went down.
That's the most important thing, yes.
Yes. And then the same thing with the COD. And the coliform. Coliform represent the population of harmful microbes along with the E. coli. And that went down to some extent, not fully. But to start with, it was not much. That's what the report is showing. But when you see the picture, I would say, it was a huge amount of coliform count. I don't know why the certificate shows otherwise, but anyway, this was it. And quickly, a wastewater nature well WW I've already spoken about. So, so this was about the slide. So, any other questions that anybody has can possibly let me know.
Yeah, that's good. And while someone is coming up with a question, what I want to suggest is. I know that you have prepared a brief video on your efforts. I wanted to put that on air so people can go through that if you don't mind, and I can put that on.
Yeah, sure. Please bear with. And one more thing, I want to talk about the video. Since we did not have the government people or other people to show any evidence, so I used these senior people who were visiting the lake frequently. And so a major part of the video is about these discussions with these senior people, both before and after. Yeah, so put on the video.
Yeah, it's very interesting because I thought that it was really brilliant that you used like senior people and asking them how it the lake used to be earlier, how it is now. So yeah, let's go through this YouTube video.
Sure.
Again, people can drag it anywhere they want to. Quite an interesting presentation. Sanjay, let me congratulate you on this presentation, because it tells us really well how the lake was at the starting and what are the efforts that you did to clean this. It was really brilliant.
Thank you. Thank you, Chandrat. I hope I was able to convey some of the information to the participants, and I thank you for the opportunity to come on air and share all the ideas and passion with everybody.
No, thank you so much. Again, this presentation was brought to you by Paryavaran.com. Most of the visitors right here are members of this Indian Environment Network that we have at www.paryavaran.com. And what we'll do also is, after this presentation is being archived. So we'll put it online, this archive presentation, so everyone can see it. And what we'll be doing is that we'll be putting a dedicated group behind it under the Global Learning School series. So if our audience or people who want to do the same thing or want to clean their lakes and have additional question, they can put up their questions right there, and Mr. Aggarwal would be more than happy, I assume, to answer all your questions and help you in cleaning your lakes in your area, because cleaning lakes should be a group effort. It's like a massive worldwide problem. It's not just for a particular community. It's not for places in India, but it's a worldwide problem. And I assume, Mr. Aggarwal, that this method can be applied anywhere in the world.
Yes, it can be, but again, it depends on the various factors. For example, in India, we have very shallow lakes. Abroad, we have deeper lakes. So again, there would be, different ways to do it. But yeah, one can apply these technologies in most of the cases, and one can get results. I would request everybody on air and people who later on see the archives to come forward and do something for your own country, because lakes are intrinsic to our development. So please, guys, let's do something together.
Again, thank you, Mr. Aggarwal, for coming up and helping me to bring this precast online and start a really learning and interactive journey together. I think we need to go beyond ideas, and this is it. We need to do implementation. Thank you again. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Chandra. Thank you, everybody, for patient listening in this lovely Sunday night. Thank you. Thank you once again.
Thank you.
Good night.
Good night.